be a form of G which contains KR at that density. Now, there are a few things that logically I should have talked about at the end of the last lecture, of the first lecture, but there wasn't enough time. So let me do this, and this will also remind you of what the purpose of all of this is. So, we call the unitarity problem. So we want to determine when the reducible Harshadra module can be turned into a unitary representation. So first of all, I may assume that the reducible Harshadra module in question has real infinitesimal character. Now, I didn't explain what that means, but I shall later in this lecture. Let's just take this as so far undefined term. And then suppose, that the problem of unitarity comes down to these subproblems. So classify the irreducible Harshadra modules. The name M. And that I will describe how so this is well understood, and I will describe this in this lecture. Then B, determine which M carry a GR invariant in each form. That is well understood. Now, I should say that this assumption plays no role in A. It doesn't really play a role in B. However, the statement in B becomes nicer when one assumes this. And in C, if so, determine what the form is constituted. So now there is what can really be called an observation of Bogen and Bogen and his school, namely real infinitesimal character. Lives also on the complexification. theta. And so when we do have a UR in the Hermitian form, namely in the case of real infinitesimal counter, then there exists also a GR in the Hermitian form, if and only if the Cartan involution lifts to
somehow the ambiguity now of the sign is
really the ambiguity of extending the action of the Cartan evolution to M. And so from the point of view of calculation, this is now not a problem. I mean, you have a normalization of the UR invariant one, and then the other one you get by applying theta, and, you know, either theta. So take the wrong theta, the emission form is negative, no problem. And now from our point of view, our meaning carrier die, you will see that the UR invariant emission form, well, you can actually write it down geometrically. And then there is no, I mean, then also from that point of view, there's a preferred choice of sign. Okay, so that is, so to speak, the end of the first lecture. Let me erase it. Semi-simple means reductive and finite center. Right? So I want to assume that GR is semi-simple, and semi-simplicity has nothing to do with field of definition. So that makes G semi-simple, and then I want to assume that G is semi-reductive. So again, this really plays no role except that it will allow me to say things more efficiently. So now I let lambda denote h2 of x with integral coefficients. So that is, there is no torsion, so this is a lattice. And I can think of it as sitting inside something that I will call h star, where German h is the complex homology in degree 2. And then it turns out that this can be naturally identified with the D-algebra of, how should I say this, of the sine Cartan subgroup of G. So, I define the notion of a Cartan subgroup of a complex reductive group, namely a product of C stars, which is maximal. And if you look at a Cartan subgroup of G, it is determined up to the action of a finite group, the value group. So to make this in some sense rigid, namely being able to explicitly identify without ambiguity two Cartan subgroups, you need to induce, you need to include an additional data. And that is the data of a positive root system. I don't want to define that, but in a moment we will see something that is equivalent to a choice of a positive root system. So, in any case, I mean, this lambda is the lattice of algebraic homomorphisms from the Cartan to C star. And then, for each lambda in this lattice, there exists a unique G equivariant algebraic line model. Such that. So if you have a line bundle, then it has a Turing class, and the Turing class is simply lambda. The Turing class of the line bundle lies in here, and it's lambda. So implicit in all of this are some remarkable properties of the flag variety, namely H2 of XZ classifies the topological line bundles in the topological category. So what this says, among other things, is that each line bundle in the topological category can be turned into an algebraic line bundle in a unique manner. And not only that, when you have that line bundle, it becomes G equivariant. Namely, the action of G on the flag variety lifts to an action on the line bundle. And now, another fact in this context is there exists a role in lambda such that L sub 2 role, well, L sub minus 2 role, I should say, is the canonical bundle. So the canonical line bundle has a square root. And everything that I said from here down to there depends on these assumptions. You know, I mean, they can be said without these assumptions, but then the statements become more complicated. Okay, so in terms of these data, I want to define P equal to P sub n. But now I say it with less detail, so the chief of differential operators on X, so linear with algebraic coefficients, and then for lambda, I should say that of course it is G equivariant. Acts on the flag variety, and of course it acts on the differential operator. And the fact that it is G equivariant means, well, G acts by translation, but then the algebra acts by infinitesimal translation. So that means that the algebra of this algebraic group G embeds into the space of global sections of P. If you have a function, you can, an element of the algebra, you can differentiate in the direction of that one parameter group that the element of the algebra generates. And that is then a differential operator of degree one that's globally defined. So we have this is part of the datum of the equivariant chief of differential operators. tensor over all would be tensored over all with all of L minus lambda plus rho. So there are various things to be said. So first of all, what is this? So this is the chief of differential operators acting on sections of the line model. Well, by definition, because we have a section of the line model, let's say locally defined, and you have something in here, then this eats the section of the line model. You become to and turns it into a scalar function. You will differentiate, you have a scalar function, and then you go back to a section of the line model lambda minus rho. So this is the sheaf of differential operators, and it acts by construction on all of lambda minus rho. And you know, you may wonder why there is this rho, and I will say something about that a little later. So, but in any case, then for lambda equal rho, so d sub rho is d. That's how things have been set up. And now, what is this? So this is a sheaf of all algebras. Well, I'm clearly multiplying a section of this line bundle by an algebraic function. That's a differential operator of degree zero. And since the line bundle is equivariant, we still have an action on G. So we still have this. So this is still, and this is still part of the structure. So there is G equivalent. And of course, the line bundle locally in the Zariski sense can be made trivial. That's by definition of a line bundle. So that means locally, O of L sub lambda minus rho is just O. So locally, lambda can be identified with the rho. And to do that simply means trivializing the line model. Yeah, so now there is something that I should, and there are a couple of what we call important facts. So first of all, so locally, O of L lambda minus rho makes sense as G equivalent. Line model. Not just for lambda and lambda, but for each lambda and H star. So what am I saying here?
H star.
Pardon?
H star. Is this an H?
G star. Lambda is an H star.
Yeah, but this is the word for the letter for H or for G that you
This is H. So lambda sits inside H star. Right? So what am I saying here? So of course, equivariance with respect to G makes no sense if I'm talking about a line bundle that's defined locally. On the other hand, if you have a line bundle that's defined, let's say, on a Zariski open set or a Hausdorff open set, it does make sense to ask for infinitesimal equivariance. That's what I'm saying here. The reason why this is true is the following, namely, locally, d lambda is d. And again, the reason that is true is that locally, the line bundle can be trivialized. And then, if you have, let's say, two that what it involves is the logarithmic derivative of the transition functions. And let's say the logarithmic derivative of f to the alpha is again an algebraic function. Right? The derivative of f to the alpha for arbitrary alpha is not, but the logarithmic derivative is. And so that's the reason why on a suitable open subsets, makes sense as G at the Bremen line number for each lambda, again on suitable open subsets of X. Not globally, certainly, but on suitably chosen open subsets, one can make sense of this. And then, of course, correspondingly, yes, of course, I said already locally, so I am saying it twice. And so, secondly, B sub lambda makes sense. Now, locally, as sheaf of algebras. And we still have this. So the line bundles make sense only locally, but the sheaf of differential operators, because that involves just logarithmic derivatives, that lives globally. And so again, as a sheaf of algebras with this additional structure, it makes sense globally for any lambda. When lambda lies in the lattice, it's the sheaf of differential operators in a line bundle. When lambda is arbitrary, well, there is no local line bundle, but there are pieces of local line bundles and it acts on all of those. Does that make sense? And now three. So we have the algebra going into here. So that means, so that's the algebra homomorphism. So that means that I can also send the, I mean, this is an embedding, but in general, you get a homomorphism from the universal enveloping algebra into here. And therefore, the center of the universal enveloping algebra acts as an algebra of differential operators on sections of this line bundle. And it acts on the section of this line bundle whether or not the line bundle exists globally in the case lambda and capital lambda, or just locally for any lambda and h star. So the center of the universal enveloping algebra acts on all lambda minus rho, and now I say this, so this even in this setting, by a character, namely the character Qaisar lambda, which I introduced in the first lecture. So in the first lecture I described it algebraically. This is a geometric way of describing it. And so then terminology a character chi from C of G into C is real. So this is the notion of real infinitesimal character. If chi is chi lambda, with lambda in R, then circle the C with capital lambda. So H is this, and of course that then would be the dual of H lower to X with real group. Okay, so those are the ingredients of the balanced and Bernstein construction. So, I mean, an obvious question to ask is what are the global sections of Isadan? This is the common term. This is a definition. real part of lambda, of course, lies in here, is dominant in the sense of the definition one. And finally, lambda in H star is regular if lambda does not lie on the union of the root hyperplanes. Now, I don't want to define the root hyperplanes, but for the purpose of this lecture, what matters is that, so for the purposes of this lecture, I'm really only looking at lambda in the real span of capital lambda. And for any lambda of this sort, being dominant regular simply means dominant and not on the boundary of regular, of dominant element. So for lambda in here, dominant regular simply means in this dominant cone but not on the boundary. So now there's following operators in Bernstein with two parts. So A, for each, now let me call it script M, in so by this I mean category of sheaves over, these are lambda, of these sheaf of modules of D over D lambda. So D lambda modules, which are regular homology. So, you know, in the last lecture, I at least gave some idea of what regular holonomic means, of course, just for D modules. But D and D lambda locally, of course, look the same. B says that a Stein manifold, any coherent sheaf, has no Hausdorff norm. So this, of course, is an analog of that. And notice that there are slightly different hypotheses. So for this statement, one needs dominant regular. This statement holds just for lambda dominant. And of course, what does happen is that there are sheaves for which lambda is dominant but not regular, which have no holomorphic sections at all. So this is the best possible statement. Now that looks like a pretty formal statement, but then it immediately implies the following. So gamma from this category to the category of finitely generated lambda model. Yeah, so what am I saying here? So if we have a regular polynomial P lambda module, well, its sections are surely a module over what I call U sub lambda. So therefore, they are U sub lambda. And then being regular monomic implies that what you get is finitely generated over U sub lambda. This is an equivalent of categories. Provided lambda is dominant regular. And is equivalent to an equivalence of categories, is equivalent to a quotient category if lambda is dominant singular. So basically what this means is that when you allow lambda to be singular, for some sheaves you have no sections at all. And of course there's something to be said that you can actually form a category by somehow dividing out these. But then the statement becomes rare. And so this is, may not be completely obvious, but this is a formal consequence of these two statements. Because you can write down the inverse. I mean, the inverse is really tensoring with B sub lambda all over its case of global section.
But I have a quick question. Do you really need holonomic here?
Yes.
But what about B lambda itself?
Well, it's certainly not finitely old.
The category that you're talking about is just lambda dominant regular. You don't need
anything more
because on the
right
hand
side. You're absolutely right. Of course, there's lambda itself.
So, of course, A and B hold under this restriction, but then the category on the right is too big to.
It's too big, that's correct. Yes, you're right.
So D lambda
is. Yes, you're absolutely right. Okay, so, but I mean, this is somehow the general statement, but what I care about is something else, namely K acts on X with finite intervals. And so let Q in X be a particular K of it. And suppose lambda is, at the moment, lambda is arbitrary in C tensor Z lambda. some household neighborhood. And what this really means is an inequality condition on lambda. Of course, what this inequality condition is depends on Q. So it's an inequality condition depending on Q on lambda. So somehow this looks like a very vague statement. I mean, this exists on some household neighborhood. Well, in fact, it's easy to check. You know, there's a certain ground condition that has to be satisfied, that's all. And so then I let J from Q to X be the embedding, and I define script M of Q lambda to be J lower star of, yes, so what I'm about to write down is morally correct, technically not quite, and to give a technically correct definition would take longer than it's worth, but I will say in words how it has to be modified. So I want to take this L lambda minus rho, which exists on some household neighborhood of Q, so I can restrict it to Q, and then what do I have? I mean, this is really, I mean, restricted to all, globally, it's just holomorphic functions. Yeah, I mean, this is the most regular, most holonomic, most anything sheaf. And so then you apply J lower star, and so by generalities, that does lie in this category. So more beyond the regular polynomial. It's known, I mean, it's easy to show, I mean, just by formal geometric arguments. Ah, yes, I should say why this is not quite one. So, the operation of D-module direct image, if you ever look at it, there is this long sonnet dance about left modules versus right modules, and it's necessitated, so I mean, there are geometric reasons why that has to be solved. And what this, if you don't want to talk about byte modules, as we do not in this context, that means essentially a shift by the top exterior power of the monomial. So really what you want to apply this to is not this, but shifted by the top exterior power of the monomial, which is also integral on the orbit. So this condition is perfectly good. Pretty well. I don't want to be totally precise here. Okay, so what you see by geometric arguments very easily is that this has a unique irreducible suction. And let me call it I. Why is it unique? Well, you take the direct image from an orbit, and you know there may be on the orbit on the boundary, there may be orbits where it can be in some sense regular. And if you take all of these possible regularity conditions, then what's left has to be irreducible. That's all. So this is not the defect. And then, so, I mean, these constructions are not E. This and that.
What's the word you just used, Wilfried?
Pardon?
I couldn't quite hear the word you just used, I'm sorry.
So, these constructions of these two sheaves are not E. And then, as a corollary of, you know, of these theorems of Davidson and Bernstein, we get a classification of the irreducible Parashkevna modules. status lambda q integral. So q integral is just this condition that this type, this virtual line bundle makes sense of the order. So then, yes, so it's q integral and done. Then the space of global sections of this unique irreducible subsheaf is an irreducible Schneider model in the Hessian character. Or zero. But zero cannot happen when I'm not ready. But it is an easy criterion, easy to state criterion for. But it's not in any way mysterious. You can just tell whether or not this sheaf has global sections. And then every irreducible Schneider model arises in this way. So this is the classification of our Schneider models. Now what does all of this have to do with human error? So let me temporarily assume that X is complex, projective, and smooth, but not necessarily a flag model. Setting there is a datum that's called polarization. which, let's say, for this characterization of the category, I talked about variations of Hodge structure. Those were to be polarized, and that defined what that meant. And then also for a point, we get the mixed Hodge structures, and they were polarized, and I said what that meant. But in this entire process, which is functorial, there is a polarization on all of these objects. And so now you may ask, what is the polarization? And if you look at Saito, it is a formal object. It's some isomorphism between, yes, so I should say irreducible. So in Saito's discussion, the polarization is an isomorphism between M and its conjugate dual, whatever that means. But then Saba gave a very geometric definition of what this polarization is. So the point is simply that when it exists, it can actually be described geometrically, and this is Saba's description. So the polarization is a non-zero D cross D bar bilinear pairing from M plus M complex conjugate. So X is an algebraic variety, well, X bar is a complex algebraic variety. So at M bar formally is then a D module for the complex conjugate. And so appearing into the sheaf of distributions from X regarded as a real algebraic variety. And it is unique at the pairing, unique at the scaling. Of course, it's unique up to scaling, and all of this is correct only when M is irreducible. So, you know, it seems that I'm not getting anywhere, and I'm already 2 minutes over time, but we'll get to the point very quickly now. So still in this general setting, suppose omega is a smooth form of property G on X regarded as a real algebraic variety. Then the polarization plus integration against omega. Yeah, let me pause very quickly here. So what is a distribution? And I think the only, if you work on manifolds, the only reasonable definition of distribution is something that is dual to compactly supported forms of top degree. Right, so one should think of distributions as being really generalized functions. So if you define it this way, then every C infinity function is in particular a distribution. But, I mean, they transform the same way every coordinate change. So that's the meaning of of distribution that I use. And of course, this So of course, what I'm saying now is I'm getting myself into trouble because it's not quite correct, but you will see. So no, it is correct actually. So the way I set things up now, things will be set correctly. So the polarization plus integration against omega defines a not trivial Hermitian pairing, Hermitian form, H from the sections of M cross, well, so a Hermitian pairing means, of course, bilinear pairing from this complex conjugate that you see. Well, I mean, this is purely formal. And I have a, if I have something in here, something in there, I apply the polarization. This gives me a global distribution, can be paired against the smooth differential form. So that is a complex mixed Hodge model. Okay, so now back to the fractal identity. And so now you are just coming back and acts finitely on the X. So there exists a unique upscaling form of top degree. You are in the form of top degree. Which observed exists when one has real infinitesimal character, but here it's actually written down explicitly. Right? And you get it from the polarization. You just integrate the polarization against the UI in your generic form of the unit. And so then, of course, so what we are after is the GR in there. But as I said at the beginning of the lecture, if you know the UR invariant form, the one in some sense, you know it pretty well, and you know the other one as well. Okay, so what comes next? So for any complex mixed hard model. Possibly twisted by a lambda. So of course I have to run force to look at these things which are in lambda models. But again, the lambda locally is deep. So as far as mixed Hodge models are concerned, the lambda really does not change anything. So the category of mixed Hodge models makes perfect sense. So for any M in here, in particular, for any M of Q lambda, phi of Q lambda, but more generally, anything that can be done, that can be gotten by, you know, the process of generating complex mixed Hodge models, so anything that is in there, one gets canonical contorial of Hodge and weight equation. So let me remind you that the weight filtration is a filtration by, it's a finite length, it's a filtration by D module. And on the level of the quotients of the weight filtration, those objects are semi-simple. So in particular, if M is irreducible, then the weight filtration just reduces to a single, there is no filtration. But the Hodge filtration is by covariant whole modules. So, and now what this implies, and you see here, this seems to be a formal statement, but there is more to it than that, and I will explain that. So, if M is irreducible, and lambda, well, lambda, first of all, I mean, in all of this, to get mixed Hodge modules, lambda has to be in the real vector space. Otherwise, this does not work. I mean, otherwise, we are not in the category of complex mixed Hodge models. But for polarization, lambda has to be real in this sense. So if we're in here, if lambda lies in here, and it's regular holomorphic, it's regular dominant, then we get a canonical functorial K invariant filtration with finite dimensional footprints sections, but you want to make sure that the global section functor behaves well. So one needs a vanishing theorem, one needs a theorem B, a certain theorem A, and so on. I mean, that actually is quite involved. I mean, one does get a filtration, but in general, you wouldn't know anything about it. So it's a well-behaved filtration. And then the conjecture is that the U invariant emission form is alternatively positive and negative definite on Fp of M intersect Fp minus 1.
Which resembles some property of the
yeah. Well, I mean, actually, so you see all of this is, I mean, M is infinite dimensional, the filtration is infinite dimensional. However, we have K acting. And each K type occurs finitely often. Yeah. So since everything is K invariant, you can fix a particular K type, then everything is finite dimensional. So another way of saying it is that this is a polarized Hodge spectrum. So that is the conjecture. And now, I mean, so we are, of course, working on the proof, and at the moment it's really only one sticking point, and it is shoved under the rug here. To make sense out of this, one needs to know that the emission form is positive, is non-degenerate on the obvious Hodge prime. And I should say that, you know, I mean, there is this theory of mixed Hodge modules, and nobody has looked at what this filtration means on the level of global sections. And so for cyclo, the global sections are irrelevant. I mean, it's this form of theory. And at some point, I asked, he said, I have absolutely no idea. And so literally, nobody has ever found any use for the filtration on the level of global sections, except, of course, this. And so in many cases, this is correct. We wouldn't call this a conjecture otherwise. And I should also say that it may or may not be correct without the Harris-Chandler structure. I mean, all of this makes sense for the lambda modules. I mean, if they're irreducible. So.
Well, that's a discussion of K-type in a sense, but this is for.
Yeah, and then we don't have K-type, sure. But I mean, formally, one can certainly ask whether this is true in general. In general, of course, to calculate examples in the Vermeer category and in the Harris-Chandler category, this is entirely possible to calculate examples without that. I mean, even on P1 minus P points. And to actually calculate these filtrations, yeah, I should say this, to actually calculate these filtrations, of course, and many cases one can, but sort of a general calculation, well, one can't, and you shouldn't expect it. Because if you could really calculate this completely explicitly, then in principle one would have a completely explicit answer about the unitary dual. And, anybody who has really looked at the subject, I think the idea that you can say when an irreducible Harris-Chandler module is unitarizable in terms of the parameters Q and lambda explicitly by some explicit description. This is not possible. I think everybody who works in the subject has come to this conclusion. So that's why Hogan and his group want an algorithm which makes a computer do the work. And in this situation, so the statement, of course, is relatively clean. But, there is no computation of the filtration. However, the filtration is factorial, canonical, and so one can do various things in this setting that one cannot do in terms of the representations. namely restricting to smaller subvarieties, restricting our general modules to smaller reductive subgroups. In general, it's a mess. If you do this geometrically, you stay in the same category. And so then you can play various games, and you know, I'm sure that one can make various statements. At the moment, we are really preoccupied with trying to prove this. I mean, there's a lot of significant machinery in this. And so I cannot say what exactly this will imply, because our main effort at the moment goes towards the proof.
Excuse me, just trying to
skipping happens on the level of the data, actually.
Okay, so there is no exact conjecture of what is
no.
the complexity to the unit. In other words, you could have the complexity grow and still be unitary.
Of course.
It's difficult, but it's possible.
Of course this happens. I think all this is an example. So of course it happens.
Yeah, okay.
But the point is that when it happens, when you see these examples, you see that somehow it is just possible. So you see how it becomes more and more difficult as the level of this filtration goes up.
Can we come back to the question of regularity?
Regular autonomy?
No, regular alignment.
Yes.
So what is the current status? If lambda is allowed to be singular, what are you allowed to do?
As you know, in the case of the discrete series, there's a compact simple rule.
Right.
And it's just that. So if you have a general orbit, there's a notion of compact imaginary. If the simple rule is compact imaginary, you have nothing, and that's the only way.
Okay. Let me ask a related question, okay? One of the major specific goals of the Bochum School, of which I happen to be a member for truth in advertising, is to study a very special class of Harshchandra models called unicodes, representations. And these typically have singular central character, singular lambda.
I mean, so for example, and I say this with not much to go on, I suspect they are again unitary for obvious reasons.
And as a matter of fact, your collaborator is not working for Vogan.
I am not.
Your collaborator, though, Steve Miller.
Oh, Steve Miller.
Was not working for Vogan.
Yes.
Is coming up with completely independent proofs that some of these unicode representations are unitary.
That's true.
So is there some way to bring...
No, I mean, I should briefly for everybody else say what Miller does. So he is an analytic number theorist, and you can, for example, you can tell that representation is unitary if it shows up on a holomorphic form. And so that's exactly what he does. So for large exceptional groups, for EA, which for example the Vogan people really have trouble with because it requires too much computation. So I mean he looks at these specific representations and he produces automatic forms which have that type at infinity, and so they are unitary.
But these, to be more precise, are these L2 residues?
Yes, of course. Yeah. Of course that's what they are.
Yeah.
Yes, so at the, so this is a totally different point of view. How it is it totally different? So, in this subject of unitarity, I think by now it's clear that if you want to have general answers, you have to do this on the level of Harshchandra models. But we are really talking about unitary representations, and then there's the question, can you see them as unitary representations? And I think, again, I think most people would agree, certainly David and you and lots of others, that to see unitarity on the level of a group representation in general, we wouldn't be able to answer questions on that level. To get systematic methods, you have to look algebraically. Nonetheless, for particular types of representations, it is possible to see them on the level of G representations. For example, the very first person who did something like this was Wilfried Schmid. know what the irreducibles are, so you see it actually geometrically. So you have, when you restrict O lambda to the orbit, you have a line bundle on the orbit. And the compact conjugate is the opposite line bundle. So you can take the section times its complex conjugate, and you get something positive on the orbit. And then, of course, everything is functorial. So if you have the orbit, then you have normalized. And of course, I should say that the Bogen and his collaborators normalize it by having a positive sign on the lowest kick height. And in the end, of course, this turns out exactly the same normalization because the lower level of our filtration includes the lowest kick height. So it's the same normalization. But here, in some sense, it tells you geometrically, well, there is real positivity. I mean, you really see positivity, it's natural.
There's a very specific example of Penrose and his crowd, where they give a global realization of certain rather degenerate representations of UPQ. Does it fit into
that? I do not know the construction.
It's because years ago they wrote down a global inner product.
On the group level. And then this fits into what I said before. Right? And so I think these are really different points of view.
Okay. Well, I was never able to explain where Chandra models to the Penrose people until Michael Eastwood made it. That was much later.
By the way, there's also the following curious fact. So, you know, you might say if you have a GR and you're in that frame, construct the GR in the product, and the reason that this is not possible in general is there is no GR invariant form of top degree. But if you take an open G orbit and there's a, let's say, and if you take an open G orbit and you have a compact graphon, for example, then you get a GR invariant form of top degree on the open. And as soon as the K orbit lies inside an open GR orbit, then you can do this directly GR invariant. So for the discrete series, for example, you can see the GR invariant in the product directly this way. But that's the only case.
What is the word polarization in the Saba sense?
Twisted case is involved in, again, in the lambda.